Welcome back. We've got a bit more to cover before we get to the hands-on. So ALB and NLB access control and encryption using SSL TLS, those are the subjects for this lesson. So let's look at how we can apply access control. So let's see, first we have a application load balancer and it has a security group. So you can apply a security group to an ALB. We've then got an EC2 instance. You can apply a security group to the instance. And you can obviously use security groups as the sources and destinations here. So we can lock down the ALB so that it only sends traffic out to the EC2 instance security group. And the EC2 instance security group can only allow data from the ALB security group. We then have connections coming in. And we've got a network ACL. Now you only have one network ACL per subnet. But I want you to remember that it actually processes data coming in and then data coming out. So the ingress and egress from the subnet. So we then have a private subnet here. That also has a NACL processing the data that's coming in. And we have an ALB and a security group and an EC2 instance and a security group. So we're load balancing to our front end and then to our application layer as well. Next, we have an ALB with a security group. Connections are coming in. We've got the network ACLs processing traffic coming in and out of the subnet. And then we have a private subnet. Again, it has a NACL and we have a security group attached to an instance. So what's happening here is we have the ALB that's public facing, has a public IP address, and it's forwarding data straight to instances in a private subnet. That's a perfectly legitimate scenario. And you just need to make sure that you specify the public subnet in the ALB that corresponds to the same availability zone as the private subnet, and then it will work. And so here we're able to filter data coming into the subnet using the NACL, into the ALB using the security group, out from the ALB using the security group, out from the subnet using the NACL, into the private subnet using the NACL, and then into and then out of the security group here going back, and of course out the NACLs going back, and you reverse the process. So there's lots of places you can apply access control. Next up, we have an NLB. Now note here, there's no security group. Key exam tip, there is no security group with an NLB. The security group is on the EC2 instance only. Then connections are coming in. Again, we can use NACLs. We have a private subnet. Again, we can use a NACL. We can have an NLB there as well. And the EC2 instance with its security group. So lots of places to process access control. And remember, with NACLs, they're not stateful, so you do need to allow traffic coming in and you need to allow the return traffic that's going back out again. Now, here's a question. What is the source IP address that the application sees? And this is important, sometimes for your application, sometimes for your security groups. So let's have a look. We've got an application load balancer. Data's coming in. And let's say the IP address is A. Obviously, IP addresses are not letters, but to make things easy, we'll call the IP address A. And we then have an application load balancer with a security group. The application load balancer has IP address B. We then got a security group. In this case, with the CLB and the ALB, they will use the private IP of the ENIs as the source address. So in this case, the source address that is going to be seen by the EC2 instance would be IPB. So in other words, if you want to lock down where your data is coming from and you want to do so by IP address, you would use the IP address of the application load balancer node. Now, you might not want to do that, but it's just to help you understand that's also what your application is going to see as well. So what about an NLB? Gets a bit more complicated. So we've got our connection coming in and the address of the client on the internet is IPA. We've then got the network load balancer, it's got IPB, and then we've got our EC2 instance. Now in this case, the instance has been added by specifying the instance ID, and this is critical because it makes a difference how you actually specify the instance. In this case, the source IP address is going to be A, so the application is going to see the IP of the client, and that's because we specified by instance ID. Let's look at another scenario. This is going to be almost the same, but the only difference is we've specified the IP address instead. So we've added the instance to the load balancer or to the target group by IP address rather than instance ID. In this case, the IP address is the IP address of the load balancer nodes. This comes up quite a bit in exam questions where they're going to test your understanding of which IP address the application is going to see or which IP address you're going to be able to use in the security group for your instances. And by the way, this is actually applicable to TCP and TLS. So for UDP and TCP UDP, this IP address would not be the node IP address of the NLB, it would be the IP address of the client. So it does get a bit complicated, but everything you need to know should be on this slide. Now, also, you need to know that when using an NLB with a VPC endpoint or an AWS Global Accelerator, the source IPs are private IP addresses of the NLB nodes. And one last point, the X-forwarded 4 can be used with ALB to capture the client IP address. So you can do it with an ALB as well. The next subject I want to cover is SSL and TLS termination. So in the first example, we've got an ALB, and the ALB has an SSL TLS cert, and that means that we have an encrypted connection coming from our client to the ALB. In other words, the encrypted connection is terminated, so it's always terminated where the SSL TLS cert is. An ACM certificate or a certificate imported into ACM or IAM can be used. So ACM is the AWS Certificate Manager. We then have our instance, and the connection that's forwarded on to the instance in this case is unencrypted. So we only have a certificate at the front end, encrypted to the ALB, unencrypted to the actual EC2 instance. With a layer 7 ELB, a new connection is established with the instance. So in other words, what's happening is the connection is actually finishing here, and then a new connection is being made through to the back end. So that's why one is encrypted and one isn't. Now let's look at another example. We've still got an ALB, and we've still got an SSL TLS cert. But in this case, we put a certificate on the back end as well. And you can use a self-signed certificate for that if you wish. This means we now have two encrypted connections, one which terminates at the ALB, and the other which is connecting to the EC2 instance and terminates at the actual EC2 instance. Next, let's look at what happens with an NLB. So we have an NLB, a client, an EC2 instance, and we have an SSL TLS cert on the instance. This must be a public certificate. Now this can work because what happens is we create an encrypted tunnel all the way through. With the NLB, the connection's not terminated at the NLB, it's forwarded straight through to the instance, so we can have our certificate here. This is a single encrypted connection straight from the client to the application. In another example, we have an NLB, client, EC2 instance, and we can have SSL TLS certs on both the NLB and the EC2 instance. And this will be two encrypted connections, one to the NLB, and then one from there to the EC2 instance. So that's how it all works, and what we're going to do now is go into a couple of lessons to get a bit of hands-on experience.